So now it's 50 days, ladies and gentlemen, almost 2 months since one LaMelo Parker was killed in broad daylight in the middle of I-10 in Biloxi, Mississippi. Investigation still going on, no word from the DA. Probably the word that will come next will be from that district attorney. From all indications, the district attorney is expected to have a grand jury seated. I want you to know that there are those of you out there right now who could very well be on that grand jury. A grand jury, ladies and gentlemen, is not a trial jury. A grand jury is seated for several things, actually. First and foremost, it is to determine whether or not there's enough evidence to charge someone. They don't decide guilt. They simply decide whether or not there's enough evidence to charge someone. And whether or not there's not enough evidence. If there's not enough evidence, there's no true bill. When it comes to police-involved shootings, what they determine is whether or not the homicide was justified or whether it was criminal. Criminal could be, in the case of LaMelo, negligence, some kind of manslaughter. I'm no lawyer, but I'm just kind of briefing myself on it. Whether it was criminally negligent. Whether, in fact, there's reason to actually charge criminally. Or whether it is a police matter. Whether they did not follow policy. The grand jury will is a pretty big stick. I don't know whether you realize this, ladies and gentlemen, but I want you to know that for those of you who are incarcerated in the Harrison County Jail, the grand jury and the grand jurors are the ones can really oversee that. They sometimes take tours of the jail. They sometimes, they can, in fact, express safety concerns or even take the warden or the sheriff to task. They can do all of that. Now, why am I telling you this? I'm telling you this because the grand jury is made up of you. You, the voter. So when that grand jury notice comes to your house, respond to it. You want to be on the grand jury. I've never been on a grand jury. I look forward to it. When it comes to a grand jury, like in the case of LaMelo here, it's not a matter of unanimous decisions. It's majority. I've talked to grand jurors. Actually, my former executive assistant was on the grand jury. It lasted for about 6 weeks. See, grand jurors are not just seated for one case, per se. They go over a period of time. And it could even go longer. It's up to the courts. You're a grand juror, you're going to meet, and then the DA will come out and he will do his, put on a case to say whether or not someone has criminally done something or not. And it's only the DA. There is no defendant. Well, the defendant can be present, so I understand. However, his attorney is not there to put on a case. There is no defense, to put it that way. And the grand jurors will hear the evidence brought against this defendant. In this case, it would be the law enforcement officers who were involved with the shooting. And it may even be the supervisor who may not have been involved with the shooting but gave the order to shoot. All of that could be before the grand jury. And the majority of those individuals in LaMelo's case would have to determine, well, okay, whether it was criminal. Whether it was criminal. Whether there's enough evidence to say that whoever pulled the trigger that resulted in this 4-month-old baby being killed should be held responsible. I want you to understand that. See, so often we think that policing and government is not about us. It is about us. I get a call all the time who tries to lead you to believe that, okay, yeah, this is government, oh, and this is they, and the proverbial, it's them and they and this, and it's us. It's you and I. If you do not participate in this, if you do not participate, trust me on this, you won't get justice. Justice right now is seeing to it that there is a reasonable explanation as to why this 4-month-old baby was shot. And by whom. So we're waiting, anxiously awaiting. But right now, I can tell you, the next phase of this is working with the grand jury. And that panel, that grand jury panel, is going to hear the evidence in the case of LaMelo and his father. I'll use that term loosely. So that's where we are. You know, folks, I come here, I do this. It is extraordinarily hard to convince someone who doesn't believe he can win that he can. And I'm going to tell you, I don't have a whole lot of patience. I really don't. For someone who has already convinced himself he can't win. I don't have a lot of patience to try to determine or try to encourage that person. Yes, you can, you can. See, I grew up with that little choo-choo train trying to make it up that hill. I think I can, I think I can. First heard it from Miss Cook in the first grade. I took it literally. I don't know whether they still have fables, rhymes, stories like that for kids, but if not, shame on you. But I do this, and I ask myself whether it's effective. I received quite a few letters that suggest to me that it is. What I just gave you, Mississippian, was justice, the keys to justice, and that's you. This grand jury has to do what needs to be done. And listen to me, I really don't think that anyone went there intentionally to kill LaMelo. I don't think that. I don't think any one of those officers. I really don't. Not the state troopers, not the deputy sheriff, not the officer with the Gulfport PD. I don't think they went there with that intent. I don't. So there. If I'm on the grand jury, I'll listen to the evidence. However, I do feel, that there could have been an intent. There could have been an intent to stop the so-called chase and have a depraved heart. The intent was to stop the chase regardless. Whoever was in it didn't make a difference to the person who fired that shot. And I think that, in many aspects, if it's not criminal, it's criminal negligence. You can't teach a police officer or anyone else how to be compassionate. You can't teach that. You can't teach a person empathy and or sympathy. And people don't care about another person. They just don't care, bro.
Can't make them.
You can't make them care. There's no training. There's no training out here to convince someone to appreciate just the simple humanity of another person. There's nothing. Nothing that's going to do it. And so when I hear someone say, well, you know, you got the training, they have to have more training, that's bull. When I hear someone say, okay, well, we're going to have some kind of sensitivity training, I think that's also bull. I've talked to a sensitivity trainer. I chuckle with him, doctor, you know who you are. I said, do you really think that the people out there who hate your guts, he's African American, when they leave this forced sensitivity training, they're going to feel any better about you? He said, no. I don't think they're going to feel any better about me. But I got paid. I got my check. And if they don't embrace what I said, then okay. And look, I get that. Which brings me to this, folks. I was asked by a police officer the other day, do I feel better about being arrested by an African-American police or a Caucasian police officer? I said, first and foremost, I don't feel good about getting arrested. I don't see the hands of those who feel good about being arrested. Go ahead, raise your hand up real high. Oh, that's right. You want the three hots in the cot. Okay, gotcha. Well, you can put your hand down. Most of us don't. I don't feel good about it. However, I said, he said, well, but if you had to be arrested, if you had to be stopped, if not arrested, who would you feel better about? I'm going to put that on our Facebook page. I'm going to tell you how I answered. You know, ladies and gentlemen, there is, all of us are a little prejudiced, based upon the environment we come from. And there's no doubt about the fact you can't ignore like kinds. You can't. But like kinds may have very little to do with complexion. I was in Africa. I didn't trust every African. I was a little bit more hesitant when it came down to some of the Africans from Somalia, for instance. A little different look. A little different demeanor. Didn't know them. A little brash. They may have been just one or two there in the airport in Nairobi, but they don't smile a lot, bro.
No.
I guess they don't have a lot to smile about in Mogadishu.
To the area.
You know. So now that I said to this person happened to be Caucasian. I said, well, you know, to be quite frank, I feel a little bit more comfortable with an African American here. Stop. He said, why is that real? He said, he's probably had some of my experiences. I would think that maybe I could relate. Or he could relate to using an Afro pig, for instance. And realizing that an Afro pig or cake cutter is not a weapon. That's what you might Kaepernick? Where is it?
Kaepernick.
This is my capper pick. Remember capper pick did the vegan thing?
Hold on.
What?
Don't move. What? Don't sudden movements. What's in your hand? Show me what's in your hand.
It's a
cap. No sudden movement.
Wait a minute. It's a capper pick.
Show me what's in your hand slowly.
It's a capper pick. It's a capper pick.
Capper pick?
Yes, a capper pick. You know, capper pick had the afro, and so he had it used to be.
So it's an afro pick?
Well, it's a cat. I come up with this is my invention. You see, it's got Kappa Pick on it. It's got him kneeling.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, yeah. I use this for afros. You know what I mean?
It's not a weapon.
Well, I mean, I could stab somebody with it. Like,
calm down. Keep your hands where I can see it.
Why you got the gun? Why you have the gun on me? Why do you have the gun on me? My hands.
What is that?
This is a Kappa Pick.
You said you could use that as a weapon.
Well, I could. You could use anything as a weapon. You use a pen as a weapon. What you talking about? I could bite you to death. What do I need to do about that?
What?
I could bite you to death if you put that gun down.
Put your teeth down, sir.
Really?
Thank you.
Jeez. Has it come to that now? I'm just that lethal? I'm not Mayor. What's the Brooks' name? What's the guy's name? Mel? Whatever his name is. I'm not the Lethal Weapon 2 guy. Just a lowly little African-American here. I can't even use this pick. You know, I just was a good invention to Afro, the Capra pick. See his face on the front?
It's pretty good.
And if we see his Afro, see that? Yeah. You guys on Facebook?
You would have thought of that.
See that? They didn't let me do it, though. Because they didn't want me to use his name. Just because I had Capra.
Spelled like that.
That's right. That's what it had spelled like that, and they didn't want that, too. So that goes $100 million. I was only selling these. I was only selling these for $2.
Sir?
What?
Please.
You again? That's what. Can you go get the brother in uniform? He's not even gonna. He's gonna say, man, hey, what you doing? There ain't nothing but an Afro pick.
What's going on here, sir? What, is that an Afro pick? Is that Colin Kaepernick on that?
Yeah, thank you, brother. I'm glad you got rid of Chuck.
I like that.
You like?
You know, Chuck is, scared.
God. Yeah, but you want to use it?
Yeah, let me get that.
Yeah,
I appreciate it, brother.
Get your crap together, brother.
Get my kitchen straight.
Hey, that don't look good under that hat, though. I can tell you, Them sideburns got to go. What, those lamb chops?
Yeah. I'm trying to bring them back.
You're not supposed to have real lamb chops, bro.
Hey, take them down.
Where do you find meat? Is that real meat?
No.
And why do they call them? I guess it does look like a lamb chop.
You know,
kind of like a T-bone. Yours look like big old T-bones. Gotta play some Elvis. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know that there's less than 1% African Americans on the Gulfport PD. Even fewer on the Harrison County Sheriff's Department. This from a county and from a city that's like 48% African American. The county's a little bit less. In Biloxi? Oh, not even better. They're pushing up against 2%. And if you counted all the desk duty people, in both situations, you understand you have far more people involved with law enforcement who are behind the desk than on patrol. In Gulfport, Biloxi, all along the Gulf Coast. A little bit better there in Jackson. Just a little bit better. Yeah, it's a lot better. And they're hovering somewhere around 50 to the 60, depending. African Americans, that is. You think it would have made a bigger difference had you had African Americans out there with LaMelo that day?
More African Americans?
No, patrolmen. It's not to say that an African American patrolman was not one of the shooters. Y'all want to place a bet? No, we can't do that. I don't know, though. Maybe we need to contact one of the casinos. The fact of the matter is, however, ladies and gentlemen, is that there is a problem here with law enforcement. And the problem with law enforcement is not law enforcement itself. It's you, the citizen. Once again, I'm coming back to you. The same ones that serve on the grand jury, the same ones that need to be in uniform. If, in fact, you got this much criticism for law enforcement, if you can sit there and see that a four-month-old baby is shot down, potentially by law enforcement, then something should tell you that just maybe you need to go into that profession. If you think you can do a better job, shut up and do it. And I want you to know recruitment's up right now. Pay has just risen there in Gulfport. The highest paid law enforcement on the coast are the ones who are investigating this case, and that's Biloxi. How ironic is that? So, go to our Facebook page and weigh in. And I know a lot of you are reluctant too. We noticed that. We did another little survey here. Yeah, you guys are very reluctant to really weigh in on this. I guess you don't want to be seen as being anti-police. And this is not being anti-police, it's pro-policing. Pro-policing. Heck, you gotta learn how to police yourself. Really? And then there's this, ladies and gentlemen. Have you noticed the number of murders lately? I just saw one the other day, I don't know where, I think it was Ohio or somewhere. Young buck got up an SUV. Looked like he took a semi-automatic, could have been a Mac-10 or something like that. And sprayed another car. In the car was children. And the guy he obviously wanted to kill or hate. And obviously did not know how to use it, but simply wanted to shoot up everybody. It's amazing. Talk about depraved heart, but the thing is what made him make that decision? What forced this? Then, of course, there's a guy on the streets where it's in New York. I don't know where that was. This could be any place, America now. Trying to kill another guy with his pants sagging. He wasn't, let me just tell you, if you guys who sag, you can't be gangster. If you are gangster, then I'm gonna tell you, thank you very much. If you are gangster, and someone's behind you, you better put your pants up, man. I mean, really and truly, you should wear some track shoes. If you know someone wants to kill you, you gotta have the garb on. Cadwal vest, even. Here's this poor guy, poor Sam. He's, by the way, he was shot. He's in his legs and in his back. He's gonna survive, or else I wouldn't be talking about it. Well, I probably would, but not like this. Here he is trying to get away with his pants below his behind. So he runs behind these two children, 5-year-old boy and his sister. They're going to the candy store. He runs, and the assailant chasing him after jumping off of a scooter. Looked like he had either a Beretta or a Glock or something like that. Fired some 12 shots. 12 shots at this guy. Running, shooting. And you guys, you know, you thug types, you guys need to go to the range. You don't, I mean, the rest, you know, just help the bystanders get shot because you don't know how to handle a firearm. And you're scared, actually. And, or you're reluctant. Or you're trying to do what you saw on TV or some video or something. I don't know. You throw the gun. You see the guy doing this, bro. Shoot, throwing this bullet. I'm going to throw the bullet and hit you. Wow. But it goes everywhere. I'd rather you not even shoot, actually. But the point is, you see this and it's your down on you. You know what? These folks really, really don't even know how to be gangsters. They really don't.
They didn't go to the...
They didn't go to the Al Capone School of Gangster.
Training school.
So here this poor guy is. He's trying to get away with his pants below his buttocks. You cannot run like that, and you can't climb a ladder. All you can do is skip. Now, if you know someone is after you, you need to have your pants up. I'm telling you, because you never know when you have to get some hat. Do you know what get some hat is? You don't know what get some hat?
I don't want to guess and be wrong.
Bro, if I had to run right now,
yeah.
I am not going to grab my crotch. I'm going to grab my hat so it won't fly off.
Oh, I see you.
You see that right there? The move right here.
I see now.
See that right there?
I see it.
Jeez.
That's getting some.
You know what they do? They do this.
They do, yeah. They are trying to run.
Skip.
And just let me say, for the record, okay, thank you for not sagging. I appreciate it.
I just, look, I hope the guy gets better. But he obviously knew they were coming from him because he started running before the guy on the motorcycle jumped off and came between the cars. Now, common sense would have told him to run the opposite direction. Instead, he's running with the traffic. So the motorcycles go in the same direction, so the guy jumps off, he's heading toward him. Well, you go back the other way.
Makes sense.
Of course, you're not thinking, but he certainly wasn't thinking because he's holding his pants. He's holding his crotch and he's trying to... It was pathetic. A pathetic display of what these guys are going to brag on now. Yeah, that's me. See, that's me getting shot and that's me. That's him.
Yeah,
my shooting him.
You saw that, right? Got away, though.
Of course, the guy doing the shooting. Without second. He had on, looked like jogging pants. Looked like he had, he came prepared. He was all in black. Of course, you realize he put on his mask while he was on his way. All the cameras saw him. Thank goodness. Now, look, I'm not saying this because it's bad. I'm just trying to, listen to me. I talked to a police officer, a friend of mine, and he said, Rip, there is a 30% chance. 30 to 40% chance that someone who's involved in the criminal subculture is going to get killed, particularly if they're an African-American male between 13 and 19. 30% chance. Now, you might be laughing at some of the stuff I'm telling you. This is serious business. If you have a boy in that age, those are your possibilities. Close to 50% chance that you're going to send your boy to school and he'll come home. Like that thug life? This is really serious. And when you look at something like that, you've got to point it out the way Rip Daniels is pointing it out to them. Look, no, don't go insulating him. I don't want him to see that, but it make him want to do it. No, he's look at this dumbass. Look how dumb this looks. See how this looks? You don't want to find yourself in that situation. You know, you want to get as far away from folks who even think like that, talk like that as you possibly can. All right, it's going to be an interesting one. Oh, is this it? You gave me the information.
That's your national. I'm still looking for your regional.
Woo, 12%. No. I was looking at something else. Boy, how few. That 10 things we need to know about race and policing. Thank you very much. This is the national, and the figures for national is far fewer, folks. I don't know what is it with you guys. You know, if you're going to be involved with the law, the best thing to do is be actually a cop, to be quite frank. Unfortunately, in the past, some cops get away with murder. I wasn't saying that to be funny either. By the way, that's been proven in my book. But it just basically shows the number of African Americans, a number of others. 62% of our police force in these United States, 62.4% is Caucasian. 17.5% is Hispanic. 14% African American. 3% Asian. 2% are unknown as to what they are, indifferent, undecided, ethnically vague, or really just don't even care. They're just real Americans. I don't know what I am. I know I'm an American. 37% have bachelor's degrees. 20% have associate degrees. That's pretty significant. Got 43,000 job openings. Whoa. And you know, the average age of a police officer is 39.4 years old. How about that? Who would have ever thunk it? Thank you for that, sir. Steadily getting information on this because I blindsided my crew over there. They're going, where is he going? This is where I am. Overall health and mortality. Young African-American males living in impoverished urban areas. About 3 to 4 times more likely to die compared to their white counterpart. As many as 1,296 more deaths per 100,000 than anyone else. So does it, you do understand what the officer told me about 40%? If your child is involved with the criminal subculture, there's a 40% chance that he ain't gonna make it. Maybe you tell him that. Maybe he'll pull his pants up and understand. The bullets really kill people. You don't undo that. Thank you for that, Amelia, bro. There's a certain kind of frustration I get when I do this.
Yeah.
Even when we do the characters, it's, and we only do it hopefully so you make a mental note. But aren't you frustrated with it?
Oh, absolutely.
What for? Well, you want to go? You kill a guy?
Right, right.
Well, you think it's going to be over then?
Yeah.
I mean, look, folks, death is permanent. Death is permanent. And your life is not everlasting. Well, not here on earth anyway. It's permanent. It's like when you do this, you cannot undo this.
And I think that's part of the anger. At least it is for me. Just that devaluation.
It bothers me. All right, 228-896-9455. I got a whole stack of stuff. We now have our first NFL player that has outed himself. Notice I did NFL gay person. That's outed now. Don't get me wrong. Do I think that they're NFL players who've been gay for quite a long time? Yeah. Point is, it didn't matter. But he wanted to make sure everybody knew it. Why? I want to pick up more guys? I don't know.
Maybe.
Okay, look, I know I'm being catty about it, but I'm really kind of over it. I mean, his business is his business, and he should not be concerned with anybody else knows his business. You know what I mean? You love who you love, but who gives a damn? You guys, you LGBT need to get over yourself. You really do. Now, and what I mean by that is not get over what you are and who you are. Get over thinking that we really give a damn. Most of us don't. It's going to take you. And those who do, you watch them. They're just as bigoted as they're insecure about themselves. You know what I mean? Could very well be going through some other kind of remorse about why they are the way they are. They have low self-esteem. But you know, there's nothing no one else is going to say to you that is going to make you feel good. They can let you feel good. They can let you feel good. Can't nobody make you. Love. love them. They ain't gonna let you. They ain't gonna let you.
All right, 228-896-9455. Let's go to the phones. I want to talk to Cowman. Haven't chatted with him in quite some time. Cowman, how are you doing?
Good morning, Mr. Dane. Good morning to your staff. Thank you for taking my call.
Let me ask you, have you gotten your vaccination yet?
No, sir.
Well, you know, Cowman, obviously you're doing the right thing. Here you are, you're driving a cab, you're interacting with people, and yet you have not had COVID. Or have you? Well, God really bless you, my friend. There's no doubt about that. I'm sorry?
I said amen to that. I had to slow down that one day. I've just been going on for over a year now, going on 2 years.
And you're still picking up fares?
Still picking up more fares now than it was 6 months ago.
Well, congratulations.
We're really busy now.
Do they have to wear masks in your cab?
Yes, sir.
Good man.
When it first was reported, this thing was out here. Uh-huh. You still have to wear the mask. I still keep you about 6 feet apart in my car. You can't sit right behind me. I got the middle seats in my van flipped over where you have to sit in the rear. I run the windows cracked. And, women, ladies, can come in, eat, and just go out. I keep my sanitizer, the wipes, my spray, my disinfectant spray.
Very good. So let me ask you, Catman, why have you not taken the vaccine?
Because I don't have an understanding of it, Mr. Dane. There's too many unanswered questions. You know, I see people on TV, and they stick a needle in people's arms, but I don't really know whether they're giving these people just plain old saline solution just to get us to take it. It's been too many deceptions, been too many untruths, been too many changes, you know, from the medical doctors too, you know. And if you change things as much as the United States government has changed since this thing come upon us, then you know that something ain't right. No one has told anyone what's in the shot. They just tell you that if you take it, you'll be saved. I mean, that's just word of mouth. What's in that shot? What is it made up of?
Well, you know, I kind of shared some of that with you, but there's no doubting the fact that there are far fewer deaths, and there's, especially among older individuals, 80% of which have gotten at least one shot, and there's no doubt about the fact that its efficacy is effective, and we have the fewest lives lost now. The day was a pretty big milestone. We fell under 10,000 infections, and the deaths are far less than just about what they were this time last year. Hang on, Cam, man. We'll be back.
Now, existing customers.